I, Nelson Rodesasa Mandela, do hereby swear to be faithful to the Republic of South Africa.
After a long struggle against the systematic legislation that upheld segregationist policies against blacks, Nelson Mandela became the first black president of South Africa in 1994. Nelson Mandela, otherwise known as Madiba, was at the forefront of the long walk to freedom. He was a social rights activist, president of an African National Congress, a lawyer, politician, and philanthropist whose goal was liberation, peace, and fairness for all blacks. In 1952, he was arrested and charged with treason, but later freed. In 1961, he led a three-day national workers' strike and was sentenced to 5 years imprisonment. A trial held in 1962 had him sentenced to life imprisonment for political offenses. This brought about a lot of international outrage and put pressure on the South African government, as Mandela had become a global symbol for black resistance. After 27 long years of imprisonment in poor living conditions, William de Klerk became president of South Africa and ordered for his release. Both went on to receive a Nobel Peace Prize in 1993. July 18th, Mandela's birthday, is celebrated as Mandela Day, where we promote peace and remember the sacrifices he made for the freedom of others.
Nelson Rolihlahla Mandela began his life herding sheep and cattle in the rolling hills of South Africa's Eastern Cape. In his autobiography, part of which was written secretly while in prison, Mandela wrote, "I was not born with a hunger to be free. I was born free. Free in every way that I could know. Free to run in the fields near my mother's hut. Free to swim in the clear stream that ran through my village. Free to roast mealies under the stars and ride the broad backs of slow-moving bulls. It was only when I began to learn that my boyhood freedom was an illusion, when I discovered as a young man that my freedom had already been taken from me, that I began to hunger for it." Nelson Mandela's given name, Rolihlahla, literally means tugging at the branches of a tree. But at school, he was given the name of another famous leader.
When I went to school, the lady teacher, Miss Mdingane, asked, "What is your name?" I told her my African name, Rolihlahla. She says, "No, I don't want that one. You must have a Christian name." So I say, "No, I don't have one." She says, "You are, from today, you are going to be Nelson."
So henceforth, he would be known to the world as Nelson Mandela. As the son of a chief, Nelson Mandela had access to the best education available to black people in South Africa at the time. Studying at Fort Hare University, where he first became involved in student protest, his refusal to accept injustice, unfairness, and inequality would last a lifetime. South Africa, 1941. In his early 20s, Nelson Mandela moved to Johannesburg, where he first encountered the racial discrimination that would later become entrenched in law by the apartheid government. Working on the mines, and later as a clerk in a law firm, Mandela pursued his law studies and joined the African National Congress, the oldest black political organization in South Africa.
It was when I came into the
Mandela. May we glorify your name and may we do justice to the legacy. please take your seats. May I kindly request those who are seated at the back to come in the middle right here so that we cover up the empty seats. Kindly, those at the back, the students from Makerere University Primary School, please come and sit in the middle here. As you move to the front, may I all ask you to bring your attention to the screens, as we're going to watch a 2-minute video to introduce the late Nelson Madiba Mandela to us all. Thank you.
Hi, Nelson Rodesasa Mandela, do hereby swear to be faithful to the Republic of South Africa.
After a long struggle against the systematic legislation that upheld segregationist policies against blacks, Nelson Mandela became the first black president of South Africa in 1994.
I, Nelson Rodesasa Mandela, do hereby swear. I, Nelson Rodesasa Mandela, do hereby swear to be faithful to the Republic of South Africa.
After a long struggle against the systematic legislation that upheld segregationist policies against blacks, Nelson Mandela became the first black president of South Africa in 1994. Nelson Mandela, otherwise known as Madiba, was at the forefront of the long walk to freedom. He was a social rights activist, president of the African National Congress, a lawyer, politician, and philanthropist whose goal was liberation, peace, and fairness for all blacks. In 1952, he was arrested and charged with treason, but later freed. In 1961, he led a 3-day national workers' strike and was sentenced to 5 years imprisonment. A trial held in 1962 had him sentenced to life imprisonment for political offenses.
Today is 20th July 2023, but as a part, Nelson Mandela's birthday is celebrated internationally on 18th July. The day was set aside by the United Nations, and in commemoration of that day, today we honor the life and the legacy of the late Nelson Mandela Madiba. Allow me to call upon the acting Vice Chancellor, Professor Hisali Eria, to give us his welcome remarks.
Parliament of the Republic of South Africa and our keynote speaker this afternoon, representatives from government, the UN resident coordinator, excellences, ambassadors and high commissioners, the chairperson and members of the University Council, members and staff, members of management and staff of Makerere University, members of the press, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you to this annual public lecture on the theme, the 10-year remembrance of Nelson Mandela, positioning Africa for climate justice and food security. I thank the South African High Commission in Uganda for staying committed to our partnership on this annual lecture series and look forward to expanding this to other areas of mutual interest. We thank you, Your Excellency. Allow me in a very special way welcome the Honorable Mandela Mandela, Member of Parliament of the Republic of South Africa, and the eldest son, grandson of Nelson Mandela. Honorable Mandela is also our keynote speaker this afternoon. It is a great honor to host you, sir, at Makerere University this afternoon. You are most welcome once again. And I hope that you will get time to visit again. Ladies and gentlemen, threats to climate lie at the very center of our future and the future of generations to come after us. This is especially important in our context, in the African context, for the reason that much of our livelihood still depends on nature. So this becomes particularly important. And because of this, the African continent will bear the biggest burden of the changes that are taking place within the climate conditions. The discussion this afternoon will not only provide insights into the extent of this problem of climate change that we are facing from the environmental point of view alone, but also it will go beyond that and look at the climate change problem from the social and equity perspective as well. And this is particularly important in our setting because, again, we are going to bear the biggest brunt, the biggest burden of these changes in the climate. We should therefore use this platform to, among other things, offer insights into what needs to be done to protect the most vulnerable groups and to ensure their food security in these changing times. In so doing, it might be interesting to identify the most appropriate instruments for the different target groups, the framework for auditing progress and the impact of the interventions that will be put in place, but also equally importantly, to ensure that we have a good balance between what the private sector can do and what the public sector can do. Ladies and gentlemen, it is also important to remind ourselves that the person we are commemorating today stood for justice and stood for equity. There can't be, therefore, a better way of remembering Mandela in this context than understanding climate change from a climate justice, or in other words, from a social justice and equity perspective. Let me end here, ladies and gentlemen, by thanking the organizers for providing a platform to deliberate on this very important issue. I thank the keynote speaker once again and our panelists for accepting to share their insights, and I look forward to the discussion that will follow. I thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Isali Aria, the Acting Vice Chancellor. At this juncture, I'd like to welcome Her Excellency Lulu Zingwana, who after her remarks will welcome the keynote speaker. Kwasi Mandla Mandela.
The Honorable Zwelivelile Mandla Mandela, Zwelivelile, the Acting Vice Chancellor of Makerere University, the Chairperson of Council for Makerere University, Ms. Lona Magala, the organizers and the members of the diplomatic corps from the South African High Commission, our friends and companies, South Africans, joining us here today. I will first start off by giving a background of this Nelson Mandela Day. Nelson Mandela was born on the 18th July 1918 in the village of Mvezo in Mthatha. He passed away on the 5th of December 2013 in Johannesburg when he was 95 years old. He would have been 105 years today if he was still alive. Nelson Mandela's mother was Nosekeni, and his father was Nkosi Mphakanyiswa Gadla Mandela. Nelson Mandela was born into the royal family of the Thembu people and was given the name Rholihlahla, which means troublemaker in Xhosa. I'm sure you will now understand where the chief comes from, the chieftaincy that he inherited from his grandfather and his great-great-grandfather. President Mandela was later given the name Nelson by his teacher when he registered at the local primary school. The teacher said everybody must have a Christian name. His father lost his chieftainship because he did not comply with the racist and oppressive laws posed against his people by the colonial and racist apartheid regimes. Nelson Mandela's father died when he was 9 years old, and he was then adopted by the Thembu king, King Jongindaba, who brought him up and took him to school, including up to university, where he studied at the University of Fort Hare. At university, President Mandela became active in politics and was expelled from the university. King Jongindaba was not pleased. In fact, he was very angry with his behavior, so he had to run away from home. He ran to Johannesburg with his cousin in 1941. In Johannesburg, he met some of his greatest friends and comrades, Walter Sisulu, Oliver Tambo, Anton Lembede, and they joined the ANC in 1942. They organized the launch of the ANC Youth League, and Anton Lembede, who became the first president of the ANC Youth League, when it was launched in 1944. Now, let me go back to my task. of introducing Chief Zwelivelile Mandla Mandela. Nkosi Zwelivelile Mandla Mandela is the eldest grandson of former President Nelson Rolihlahla Mandela. He was born in Johannesburg. His father was the second eldest son of President Mandela. He was Makgatho Mandela, and he worked in Johannesburg as a lawyer at the time of his death. His mother was born in Gamarishane in Limpopo, the northern province of South Africa. She is currently the regent, the Queen Regent of Mvezo, a traditional council, as the Chief Zwelivelile is in Parliament. Nkosi Zwelivelile Mandla Mandela is an ANC Member of Parliament and the chairperson of the Portfolio Committee on Agriculture, Rural Development and Land Affairs in our Parliament. He is a freedom fighter, human rights activist who fights for the rights of oppressed and marginalized people in South Africa, Africa, and the world. He holds a BA degree in political science and a postgraduate diploma in international relations from Rhodes University in Grahamstown. He is also a farmer and a champion for rural communities and the rural poor. We believe he is the right and most relevant speaker for us today, as we all remember the theme for today is positioning Africa for climate change and for climate justice and food security. We therefore believe, as the chairperson of the Portfolio Committee on Agriculture, Rural Development, and Land Affairs in Parliament, he is the best speaker for today. As I said, he is also the grandson, eldest grandson of former President Nelson Rolihlahla Mandela. Before I sit, I just want to report that on Friday, the 14th of July, we held our 67 minutes of community service with the young students that you see here today. Where are you? They've gone out now. Where are the students? They will join us later. We spent 67 minutes of community service at the Makerere University Primary School, which is not far away from here, planting trees at the school. Also, later on, cleaning and painting part of the school. This was in keeping with the theme of the Nelson Mandela Day this year, which is positioning Africa for climate change and food security. And therefore, this is why we started off by planting 67 fruit trees at the school, where we were led by the Vice Chancellor of Makerere University, Professor Barnabas Nawangwa, as well as the school principal and the students of Makerere University School. We did this as the South African High Commission in partnership with Makerere University and FOSABU, which stands for Forum for South African Businesses in Uganda. The companies that participated, and I would like to give our heartfelt appreciation, our gratitude, for the contribution that they made on Mandela Day, starting at the school until today. These companies include MTN Uganda, Stanbic Bank Uganda, MultiChoice, and some of the representatives of the companies were also at the school planting trees and cleaning with us. We also had a donation, highly appreciated, from Tree Adoption Uganda, a local company that donated about 70 trees for planting at the school. We also had a donation of books and pencils from Gusto Bookstore, SWT Tenors, and paint from Plascon Kansai Paint. Can we give them a hand for that support? I therefore want to say that for the learners today, I can see them coming in. This is the message from Nelson Mandela, that we have to be able to stand on our own and be of service to our community. The 67 minutes of service represent the 67 years of fighting for peace and justice, for human rights by Nelson Mandela. You'll remember I said he arrived for the first time in Johannesburg in 1941. He joined the struggle in 1942. And if you look at the day when Nelson Mandela International Day was declared by the United Nations, which was in November 2009. Now from 1942 to 2009, that is 67 years of struggle. On this day, people around the world spend 67 minutes to promote volunteerism and community service in honor of Nelson Mandela's legacy. So these young students here also spent 67 minutes to honor Nelson Mandela. Today we are fortunate, therefore, and humbled to have Tata Madiba's grandson, Nkosi Zwelivelile Mandla Mandela, present the Nelson Mandela Memorial Lecture to us. Ah, Zwelivelile. We invite you to come and present the lecture.
Before we have the keynote address, among us today we have students from Nabisunsa Girls School, and one of them is Miss Najinda Mason Mulumba, who is going to present to us a poem entitled "I Am Prepared to Die." If you've watched a few biographies of Nelson Mandela, you know he's quoted to say these words. So her poem is dedicated to the life of the late Nelson Mandela. You're welcome. Miss Najinda. As she comes up, after her, we'll have the keynote address.
Guest of honor, Her Excellency Lulu Zingwana, our keynote speaker, Mr. Mandla Mandela, our counselor, Professor Umar Kakumba, our panelist, protocol observed. Good afternoon. Nelson Holishaza Mandela's statement at the opening of the defense case in the Rivonia trial was delivered in the Pretoria Supreme Court on 20th April 1964. Before the trial, Mandela and the other defendants decided that instead of testifying as witnesses and submitting to cross-examination, he would make a speech to put the state on trial and point out the injustices of society and the legal system in South Africa. The critical discourse analysis attempts to expose hidden strategies of domination and inequality in discourse, as the charges were of sabotage and conspiracy, and it was likely that they would be found guilty. This speech focuses on the struggle against apartheid in South Africa for social equality and political rights for all. As he stands on the dock at the Palace of Justice in Pretoria, Nelson Holishaza Mandela delivers his speech, of which he says that he is prepared to die. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you the Nelson Mandela of the modern day era, Najinda Maisun.
I am the first accused. I hold a bachelor's degree in arts and practiced as an attorney in Johannesburg. Influence of foreigners or communists. Stories of the old days. Related to me were those of wars for our ancestors in the defense of the fatherland. The names of Dingane and Bambata, Hinsa and Makana, Skunki and Lassila. I hope then that life might offer me the opportunity to serve my people and make my own humble contribution to their freedom struggle. This is what has motivated me in all that I have done in relation to the charges made against me in this case. And at some length with the question of violence. Some of the things so far told to the court are true, and some are untrue. I do not, however, deny that I planned sabotage. I did not plan it in a spirit of recklessness, nor because I have any love for violence. I planned it as a result of a calm of the political situation that had arisen after many years of tyranny, exploitation, and oppression of my people by the whites. I admit immediately that I was one of the persons who helped to form Umkhonto we Sizwe, and I played a prominent role in its affairs until I was arrested in August 1962. I deny that Umkhonto was responsible for a number of acts which clearly fell outside the policy of the organization and have been used in the indictment against us. I do not know what justification there was for this act, but I would like to know that this act would not have been authorized by Umkhonto. I already mentioned that I was one of the persons who helped to form Umkhonto. I and the organization did so for two reasons. Firstly, We believe that as a result of government policy, violence by the African people had become inevitable, and that unless responsible leadership was given to control and canalize the feelings of our people, there would be outbreaks of terrorism, which would produce an intensity of bitterness and hostility between the various races of this country, which is not even produced by war. Secondly, without violence, there would be nowhere open to the African people to succeed in their struggle against the principle of white supremacy. Opposition have been closed by legislation and were placed in a position in which we either had to accept a permanent or to defy the government. We chose to defy the law. We first broke the law in a way that avoided any recourse to violence. When this and the government chose a show of force to crush opposition to its policies, only then did we decide to answer violence with violence. But the violence we chose to adopt was not terrorism. We who formed Umkhonto were all members of the African National Congress and had behind us the policy of non-violence and political dispute. We believed that South Africa belonged to all the people who live in it and not to one group, be it white or black. We did not want an interracial war and tried to avoid it to the last minute. If the court is in doubt about any of this, it will be seen that the whole history of our organization bears out what I have said and what I will subsequently say when I describe the tactics Umkhonto decided to adopt. I want, therefore, to say something about the African National Congress. The African National Congress was formed in 1912 to defend the rights of the African people, which had seriously been curtailed by the South African Act and were being threatened by the Native Land Act. For 37 years, that's until 1949, it adhered strictly to constitutional struggle. It put forward demands and resolutions. It sent delegations to the government in the belief that African grievances could be solved through political means and that Africans could advance gradually to full political rights. The white governments remained unmoved, and the rights of the African people was seen to become less instead of becoming greater. In the words of my leader, Chief Luthuli, who became president of the ANC in 1952 and who was later awarded the Nobel Peace Prize, who will deny that 30 years of my life have been spent knocking in vain, patiently, moderately, and modestly at a closed and barred door? What have been the fruits of moderation? The past 30 years have seen the greatest number of laws restricting our rights and progress. Until today, we have reached a stage where we have almost no rights at all. During my lifetime, I have dedicated myself to this struggle of the African people. I have fought against white domination. I have fought against black domination. I have cherished the ideal of a democratic and free society in which all persons live together in harmony and with equal opportunities. This is an ideal for which I am prepared to live for and to see realized. But my Lord, if it needs be, it is an ideal for which I am prepared to die.
Across the island into the bay. respected Master of Ceremonies, Her Excellency the Ambassador or the High Commissioner of the Republic of South Africa, Mam Lulama Qingwana, Your Excellencies in the Diplomatic Corps, the leadership and academics, students of Makerere University, allow me to also acknowledge the acting Vice Chancellor of Makerere University, the sponsors that have made this day possible, MTN, Stanbic Bank, as well as MultiChoice, and various other companies from South Africa and locally here in Uganda, honorable guests, the respected members of the media, ladies and gentlemen, and to our youth, the future leaders of our beautiful continent. Ladies and gentlemen, comrades and friends, good afternoon. I greet you this afternoon with the universal greetings of peace, justice, and dignity for all. I am indeed honored to be in your midst this afternoon. It is an even greater honor for me to address you here in Makerere University, one of the foremost and erudite centers of higher education on the African continent, with a proud history. As I entered the university, I sat wondering over a century of producing African excellence, and for that, we applaud the leadership and students of Makerere University that have not only made Uganda proud, but East Africa and the greater African continent by continuously producing leaders that continue to serve our beloved continent. Allow me to extend my sincere gratitude to Her Excellency, the High Commissioner, Umama Qingwana, for extending the invitation for me to be here in Uganda and be able to address you on the occasion of the 2023 Nelson Mandela Memorial Lecture, coined as Positioning Africa for Climate Justice and Food Security. I would therefore like to acknowledge all who have made this event possible, and especially all of you who have been participating in the activities of the International Nelson Mandela Day, coined by the United Nations. Here we gather in Kampala and all around Uganda, you participated in these global events, as we too in South Africa, in the SADC region, the greater continent, joined the global community in celebrating and honoring the founding father of our nascent democracy. There is an old African proverb that says, I quote, "If you don't know where you are coming from, you will never know where you are going," close quote. I say this to give context to our topic today, because seeking climate justice is foremost an admission and an axiomatic truth that climate injustice prevails. How we think about climate justice is in itself instructive. Frantz Fanon, one of Africa's greatest writers, who explained in his book, The Wretched of the Earth, I quote, that colonialism was never satisfied with the conquest of the colonized, also worked to steal the colonized people's history and to epistemically intervene in the psyche, close quote. How we position Africa for climate justice must firstly be restorative in terms of our traditional knowledge systems that govern how we preserve our values and how those values direct the choices we make about our past, present, and future. This we must do it in the context of the UN Sustainable Development Goals under principle of leaving no one behind. Leaving no one behind is a core principle of the 2030 agenda and the SDGs ensuring inclusive development. It requires addressing the needs of vulnerable populations, not just income poor, a comprehensive approach beyond single factor matrix, which is necessary to understand and tackle intersecting disadvantages and achieve sustainable progress for all. Emphatically, it deals with the climate change challenges, which we must leave no one behind. There is a real danger that we define the challenges and pursue solutions that not only keep us busy, but also refocus our attention away from other aspects of our lived reality. Aimé Césaire, in his Discourse on Colonialism, published in 1955, argues that the colonial project was never benevolent and always motivated by self-interest and economic exploitation of the colonized. We must be mindful that shaping the discourse of climate justice does not lead us into another chapter of neocolonialism. The African Union's acknowledgement of the role and contribution of colonialism is in the context of the climate change, which is an important recognition of historical responsibility and its impact on the current challenges faced by the African countries. Colonialism, which involved in the exploitation and extraction of natural resources by colonial powers, has had lasting effects on the socio-economic and environmental conditions of many African nations. During the colonial era, European powers established industries and extractive practices that often prioritized short-term gains for the colonizers at the expense of long-term sustainability and the well-being of local populations. These industries often relied on the extensive use of fossil fuels, leading to significant carbon emissions and environmental degradation. As a result, many African countries now face the adverse impacts of climate change, including more frequently and intense extreme weather events, rising sea levels, prolonged droughts, the ecosystem and agriculture. Disproportionately affect communities, including indigenous people and marginalized populations who often have limited resources and adaptive capabilities and capacity. The call for climate change justice by the AU seeks to address this historical legacy and the disproportionate burden that African nations bear regarding the impacts of climate change. Climate change justice aims to ensure that those who have contributed the least to global carbon emissions, like many African countries, are not left to bear the brunt of its conquests and its consequences. By highlighting the historical role of colonial industries in contribution to carbon emissions and the current challenge of climate change, the AU aims to advocate for equitable and fair climate action and support from the international community. These include assistance in building climate resilience, access to clean energy technologies, financial support for adaptation, and technology transfer to enable sustainable development in the region and the broader African continent. Climate change justice also calls for a collective global effort to mitigate the greenhouse gas emissions and limit global warming, recognizing that addressing climate change is a shared responsibility. This approach emphasizes the need for developed countries who historically contributed to the most to carbon emissions to provide financial and technological support to developing nations to tackle climate change and foster sustainable development. In thinking about climate justice, I want to borrow the thesis of Ngugi wa Thiong'o in his Secure the Base, Making Africa Visible in the Globe, about the four journeys of capital and plotting the fate of Africa. He had this to say: the first raises the question of what the impact was of slavery on the African environment and the export of its human resource as cargo. Secondly, what was the impact of exploitation of African labor on the plantations and mines that fed and laid the edifices for the European economy, and to a large extent still does to this very day? Thirdly, the colonial division of Africa and its resources for the benefit of Europe, fostering civil war in post-colonial societies and regime change to continue the plunder. Fourthly, the debt slavery whereby a poor continent finances the developed countries of the world. We are talking about climate justice, knowing full well that the biggest perpetrators of environmental degradation will not carry the bulk of its burden. This is the immediate danger that we face as we contemplate positioning Africa for climate justice and food security. Comrades and friends, let me cite one example before I speak broadly of the principles of climate justice and some of the issues we have to contend with as we position Africa for a just and prosperous future. One of the most palpable areas impacted is that of food security. The impact of hunger in Africa is severe, with a significant concentration of the world's hungriest people in Ethiopia, Kenya, and Somalia. As of the final months of 2022, These three countries accounted for 70% of the world's most insecure populations. The situation has been worsened by a crisis in the Horn of Africa, resulting from multiple consecutive failed rainy seasons. This crisis has intensified hunger in the region, affecting over 36.1 million people who are facing food insecurity and its devastating consequences. In Africa, the situation of hunger remains alarming, with significant proportions of the population affected. According to the World Vision, in the year 2020, one in five people of the continent faced hunger. Even more concerning is that the number of hungry people continues to increase, exacerbating the crisis. Furthermore, over one third of the Africa's population, or more than 33%, experienced undernourishment, highlighting the severity and persistence of the issue of food insecurity in the region. This poses a significant challenge to the efforts aimed at achieving food security and sustainable development in Africa. The scale of hunger in Africa is deeply concerning, surpassing any other region in the world. A staggering 282 million people on the continent were experiencing hunger, highlighting the severity of the crisis. Nowhere else does hunger affect such a large portion of the population. The situation is particularly critical in East Africa, where conditions are deteriorating rapidly. Within this region, a devastating 7.2 million people are at risk of starvation, and an additional 26.5 million people face acute food insecurity, indicating an urgent need for humanitarian assistance. Tragically, the impact of this crisis on children is profound. At least 12.8 million children in East Africa are acutely malnourished, underscoring the grave consequences for the region's future generations. These figures, comrades and friends, emphasize the urgent need for the collective action and support to address the food insecurity crisis in Africa, particularly in East Africa. Humanitarian organizations, governments, and the international community must work together to provide immediate aid, sustainable solutions, and a long-term support to combat hunger and the malnutrition effectively. We now consider the concentration of ownership and control throughout the agricultural and food value chain as a matter of significant concern. Across the world, this chain is heavily monopolized, extending from the ownership of land to various aspects of agricultural production, processing, and distribution. Ownership of land, the large-scale land ownership, is often concentrated in the hands of a few powerful entities or corporations, limiting access to land for small-scale farmers and communities. When you look into agricultural inputs, the production and supply of essential agricultural inputs, such as seeds and fertilizers and pesticides, are dominated by a handful of agrochemical companies, reducing options and increasing dependency for farmers. Thirdly, we can also look into agricultural implements and the equipment farmers use, companies with significant market power control the manufacturing and distribution of agricultural machinery and equipment, therefore influencing access and affordability for farmers. In looking into infrastructure and logistics, infrastructure including transportation and storage facilities is often controlled by major players in the food industry, impacting the efficiency and cost effectiveness of food distribution. Again, we can speak and look into processing and packaging, where a few large corporations dominate food processing and packaging, determining the quality and pricing of food products available in the market. And lastly, wholesale and retail. The wholesale and retail sectors are often dominated by a handful of big players influencing pricing and the variety of food products and produce available to consumers. The monopolization can have several adverse effects, which are limited choices for farmers, where farmers may face reduced choices in inputs, leading to a potential dependency on a few suppliers and limited access to diverse and sustainable farming practices. On food systems vulnerability, the concentration of control in food system can create vulnerability and disruption or changes in the practices of a few major players can have far-reaching impacts. On price control and profit maximization, the dominant players in the value chain may influence prices to maximize their profits, potentially leading to higher prices for consumers and lower income for farmers. On environmental impact, the dominance of certain agrochemical companies and practices can contribute to environmental degradation and unsustainable farming practices. Comrades and friends, addressing this monopolization requires efforts to promote fair competition, support small-scale farmers and producers, and encourage sustainable and diverse agricultural practices. Policymakers, consumers, and civil society play essential roles in advocating for more inclusive and equitable food systems that benefit all stakeholders along the value chain, emphasizing local and sustainable food systems, which can also help reduce reliance on centralized and monopolized supply chain, fostering resilience and greater food security. We cannot engage positioning Africa for climate justice and food security without understanding this, and it is an imperative that we engage what is advanced as the pillars for achieving climate justice. Just transition is just not about transition. We must ask the difficult questions. For example, our recent experience in South Africa is telling. Shortly after signing the Eskom Just Energy Transition Project, a $497 million project approved by the World Bank in November 2022, the demand for South African coal soared drastically, especially in the European Union. We must indeed move away from harmful and dirty fossil fuels to cleaner, affordable, and sustainable renewable energy sources. However, we must ask, how sustainable is sustainable when we are still reliant on finite mineral resources such as lithium and coltan for the manufacture of batteries to store solar power, for example. Some of these minerals are mined by minor children in environments that lack health and safety standards and unduly expose them to radiation. Rehabilitation of these areas is not even on the agenda. Comrades and friends, I have already made reference to social, racial, and environmental justice as important legs of climate justice. However, these issues cannot be viewed in isolation of their historical context. The call for indigenous climate action is real as we witness the adverse impact of droughts, floods, and the destruction of vulnerable topsoil, not to mention destruction of homes, lives, and livelihoods. The solution of these challenges must indeed be homegrown, but we cannot do that without acknowledgement of the fact that our contribution to the problem is negligible in comparison to that of developed nations. That does not absolve us from responsibility. On the contrary, it places upon us a double burden of care, protection, and concern for future generations. It is often cited that the United States of America constitutes 4% of global population, but it contributes a quarter or 25% of carbon emissions. So it is once again African solutions to a problem created elsewhere. Nonetheless, we have to deal with the reality and the impact that it has on us. Community resilience and adaptation are built into our DNA, as it is the will to survive, a common human trait. How do we advocate community resilience and adaptation under conditions of deep-rooted, endemic, and systematic poverty? We are resilient and willing to adapt. That is evident from nearly four centuries of colonial occupation. But we must ensure that communities, especially rural communities, have access to the resources to enable resilience and adaptation. The question is how? Comrades and friends, many who advocate for just transition demand accessible and affordable electricity, corporate and business reform, a shift in the ownership of energy, empowerment of workers and communities, and environmental restoration and protection. Beyond positioning Africa at a macro level, we must ask how communities participate in the generation of energy, how communities will benefit from corporate and business reform in the energy sector, and how communities will participate in the shift of ownership of energy. Africa is still rich in natural resources, both in terms of green economy constituted by our flora and fauna, and the blue economy, our rivers, lakes, and seas, and all that it contains. Both have areas that are under extreme threat and require sustained and intensive interventions in seeking natural climate solutions to these pressing challenges. We must return to our ancestral values that govern how we relate to our environment. Most natural climate consultants focus on leveraging or monetizing the value of these resources and extracting economic leverage while mitigating or reducing the risk of destruction and degradation. Comrades and friends, climate education and engagement are imperative, but must be rooted in our own African values and narratives. The resources must speak authentically to our experience and must not whitewash the sins of colonialism and their continued responsibility for reparation, restoration, redistribution, and reform. We must grow awareness of the realities of climate justice from the grassroots up by engaging communities, youth in particular, community-based organizations, our traditional leaders, and other structures of civil society. Communities are the first to experience negative climate change impacts like heat, death, and illness, respiratory illness, infectious diseases, and economic and cultural displacement. We must protect our most vulnerable communities and ensure that we heighten awareness while building capacity to deal with issues arising from climate justice. We must continue to build awareness in our communities that global climate change will accelerate unless we can slow the release of greenhouse gases into the atmosphere. We must therefore find alternatives for those human activities that cause global climate change. It is the most vulnerable individuals and communities that will suffer the most from climate change's impact. We need to provide opportunities to adapt and thrive in the changing world. Comrades and friends, this goes without saying that the transition from a fossils fuel-based economy to a renewable energy-based economy is fraught with both challenges and opportunities. It is critical to consider how we navigate addressing the challenges while ensuring we create and optimize the opportunities. We must give due consideration for displaced workers and communities to participate in the new economic order through compensation for job loss, loss of tax base, and other negative effects. Such interventions must include skilling and reskilling and providing alternative avenues to support themselves and their families. Climate justice is at its root a bold statement which says nothing about us without us. We must not only seek community benefit and participation, our voices must be heard at all levels in the processes that shape policies, programs, and projects. It is not sufficient to say that global problems need global solutions. We must build strong global alliances of developing countries that share a common experience and carry a common burden. We must work together cooperatively to stop global climate change, but we must be at the table that ensures that we are not lumped with the burden while the developed economies will come in the future. We should take into account the impacts of future generation in deciding policy today. Let us not rob our children of the dreams, for that is their right. They should have the opportunity for success through sustainable use of resources. Ladies and gentlemen, I thank you for the invitation and the honor of having to address you here at Makerere University on this Nelson Mandela Lecture of 2023. Thank you.
Round of applause for Nkosi Mandla Mandela. May I request him to take a seat on the stage as we go into the next session. As he spoke, the highlight for me was climate education and engagement is imperative but must be rooted in our own African values and narratives as we position Africa to, for climate justice and food security. Or as the late Nelson Mandela once said, sometimes it falls upon a generation to be great. You and I can be that generation that positions Africa to be the place that we need it to be for the young children who are seated with us here today. Allow me to recognize a few people who are here with us today. Mrs. Nabilia Juliet, the headmistress of Makerere University Primary School, you're welcome. It's a pleasure to have you today. Allow me to also recognize Miss Rehema Ndagire, the mother of the modern day Mandela, Miss Najinda Mason. It's a pleasure to have you, madam. As we get into the next session, which is the panel, allow me to invite Dr. Nansozi Mwanga to come and moderate the panel. Dr. Nansozi Mwanga is the executive director of the Julius Nyerere Leadership Center. She was the first woman to head the Department of Political Science and Public Administration at the university in its 65 years. Of existence. Dr. Nansozi Mwanga has over 35 years of research, teaching, administrative experience at this university, the University of Toronto, and Stanford University. In addition, Dr. Nansozi Mwanga is a member of the Scientific Committee and the Council of the Development of Social Science Research in Africa, Dakar, Senegal. You're welcome, Doctor. Dr. Nansozi, I request you to invite your panel. Thank you.
It's my pleasure. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's my pleasure to invite my two panelists sitting over there. First of all, Professor Mwanga. And Mr. Moses Jock Kulo Arung. I hope I've pronounced it right. Shook hands. First of all, guest of honor, Your Excellency Ambassador Lulu, our keynote speaker, Honorable Chief Mandela Mandla, Chair of University Council, Mrs. Lona Magara, the acting Vice Chancellor for today, Professor Hisali Eria, members of the Diplomatic Corps, students, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. I don't know about you, but I am still reeling from that presentation. And I'd like us to give another round of applause to our keynote speaker, because it gives not only food for thought, but it brings us to a different place in terms of understanding not only climate change, but also the issue of food security. Thank you very much, our guest speaker. I am particularly happy to be here because the late President Nelson Mandela regarded Nyerere, the center where I lead, as a mentor, as a friend, and praised his role in liberation. But more than that, he also saw the late President Nyerere as an ally and key to our development as a continent, and specifically evoking the issue of Pan-Africanism and socialism amongst us. So I'm really happy on that part. The issue of climate change, we've heard, and I'm not going to go through the whole lecture as it's been, raises a number of questions that I think I would like my panelists here today to be able to address and maybe speak to. The issue is that by 2030, it's estimated that over 118 million people, poor people, will be exposed to droughts, floods, and extreme heat in Africa. And in addition to that, the climate change not only lower the domestic product, but also it presents a serious challenge to climate adaptation and resilience actions. So when our keynote speaker spoke about no one being left behind, that resonated. But in so far as it resonated, it also raised a question for me. Who aren't we leaving behind? When our keynote speaker said that action must be taken, and taken immediately, and must be taken within our own context, within our own understanding, and using our own narratives and our own history in order to be able to understand it. Again, the question for my two panelists is, what does that actually look like in real life? Where should the focus be? How can Africa actually reposition itself? Is it through early warning signs? Is it enhancing countries' early warning systems? Is it building integrated systems? And these are questions that I would like my two panelists to speak to, and of course, our esteemed keynote speaker will also be here for guidance. But those are the questions that I'd like my two panelists to speak to this afternoon. Because the issue of community, the issue of not leaving anyone behind, the issue of ensuring that whatever solutions are developed must be steeped in our own narrative, in our own history. I think those are very, very strong words and also very strong ideas, and I'd like my two panelists to please speak to them. I'll start on my right with Mr. Ajok, and to give you 5 minutes, okay, 10 minutes, to give your submission.
All right, thank you very much, Madam Nansozi. My name is Moses Jok. I am a fifth year student at Makerere University doing Bachelor of Dental Surgery. I also serve as the 89th Minister for National Students Affairs in the Students Guild. I also serve at the GRC for School of Dentistry. I serve as the deputy speaker for South Sudanese Students Union in Uganda. Impliedly, I'm from South Sudan. So I am very, very excited to be here to discuss how we can position Africa for climate justice and food security. Well, to begin with, as it was stated in the lecture, I thank the keynote speaker for literally talking about everything. It stated very well that we cannot solve anything unless we have understood what it is. So the first thing to positioning Africa to climate justice and food security is having a full understanding of the situation. So yesterday I was going to my internship place. I ordered for a safe border, and the border man came. I had seen the price already on the safe border portal. So it was around 3,000 Ugandan shillings. But then when he reached me, he was like, bro, you're going to earn me 1,000. I said, why am I adding you 1,000? Yet it's very clear it is 3,000. So for him, he said, first of all, these people are going to cut off 15% of what I will hand from you. Secondly, the place is very far. And therefore, I request that you understand my situation, because my job, like the job I'm doing right now, is my part-time job. I asked him, what's your full-time job? And of course, now I already decided to give him the 1K. He said, my full-time job is being in Africa. So, and I was really amazed, because he knew a lot of things about why being in Africa is a full-time job. He probed it, and I was very happy with him. So, ladies and gentlemen, being in Africa is a full-time job for us. And at this moment, we have food crisis. Just as it was stated before, that 1 out of 5 people in Africa sleep hungry. I think it remains figures until when we bring it to who we are. For example, the campuses here can really relate that. 1 out of 5 people sleep hungry, at least one. So, and this is riddled with a lot of things. First of all, we talk of the Ukraine war. We talk of COVID-19 scars. We still have them in our economy. We talk of soaring inflation in every country. Talk about the harsh climatic conditions. So all those things are contributing to Africa being a full-time job for all of us. So, but in this case, to fully tackle the question of how we can place Africa for climate justice and food security, I think it places us to about 70% of the current crisis we have. So to me, how I would approach this, having fully understood the crisis, number one, Africa is a useful continent whereby around 60% of the 1 billion population of people are below 25 years of age. So whatever we do, whatever approach we take to tackle this problem of climate change and food insecurity, it has to be really in line with what can be done by the youth normally. So I can say that number one, we have to front the whole idea of climate proofing Africa. How can we climate proof Africa? First of all, looking at the condition of the climate change, it is because we can set the strategies to mitigate climate change. But at the end of the day, it has to be a collective global effort. So I believe we can manage the situation by climate-proofing Africa. How do we do that? We have a lot of institutions, we have researchers, we have scientists, and we have development organizations that are ready to solve anything. So me, I would say that we use all these resources we have, the scientists and all those, and we use them to empower the local farmers who are struggling with the crisis of climate change. And I think by doing that, we are positioning the continent in a better way to face the refugee crisis. Number two, I would also think of empowering the youth. Just as I said, the population is to a great extent a youthful population. So we empower the youth. Okay, the definition of the youth is diverse, but basically people below 30 years of age. So we empower them through activism. I really thank the High Commission of South Africa for surely engaging the young people in Nabisunsa, and I think this is just a sample of many other students they are trying to, you know, empower. So I think we should bring on board these young people and teach them how it is dangerous for us to be in a situation of what? Of climate injustice. How it can bring the food insecurity. And number two, in the institutions of learning, I also think that we can empower the youth. For example, at Makerere University, we have a full ministry that is for environment, that is in the Students Guild. So this ministry can be empowered, and it can be able to, you know, organize conferences, so we can teach people. We can go to communities and teach them that planting trees is far better than cutting them down, because if and people who are really affecting the issue of, so the people who are being affected by the issue of the climate change. I think I have taken a lot of time, but to summarize, my approach would be empowering the youth through the means I've talked about, and yes, continuing to understand the problem as we tackle it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm not going to comment. I'll wait until the second panelist has had a chance to also give his submission. Professor.
Thank you very much, moderator. And I'd like to add my voice. In looking at who should be handling this case, I think the modern day Mandela is already showing us that we have troops ready for this very serious task. Clearly, this is a very important topic. Positioning Africa for climate justice and food security, I think the keynote speaker gave us adequate information to acknowledge the fact that Africa is bearing the highest burden. Some literature says that 1% of the wealthiest do emit more greenhouse gases than 50% of the poorest. So this burden, the poor are carrying it, but they are contributing very little. And I think the lecture brought that out very well. Some advocates, and I'm almost happy that our keynote speaker didn't get into that direction, some advocates are arguing that maybe since we haven't contributed that much, it's now our time to contribute. So let's be free to produce, mine our minerals, use our gas without bothering. But clearly, we have future generations to think about, and I'm glad that the panelist who spoke before me has highlighted the youth. Those we have here and those yet to be born, it's really our responsibility to make sure that we hand over an environment that can sustain those generations. But having said that, yes, the problem is known and there is injustice. I think that was well explained. We are carrying a burden that we have contributed very little to. What can be done to reduce this burden and who should be driving that agenda? Starting with who, clearly it is everybody. I think we have roles for government, we have roles for all individuals to ensure that our living is responsible living. We have an insatiable appetite. As people get wealthier, their consumption really increases. From a 2,000cc vehicle, you'd like a 5,000cc vehicle. If as individuals, we start auditing our lifestyles and making sure that we are not worsening the situation. I think that is something we all have a duty to contribute to. But one important thing that the keynote speaker did address it is collaboration. If you think about Africa, which is one of the hardest hit regions, we have common problems. Most of our farmers are smallholder farmers who cannot afford things like irrigation. So when there is drought, they are hit very hard. Many of our people are poor, and if there is an increase in prices, they are the ones who are going to get into the hungry, the statistics for those who are hungry. So I would like to suggest that even though there are these international fora and very, very powerful and a lot of resolutions are happening there, Africa has a responsibility to make sure that their voice is one voice. Our governments, our people should be speaking as one because we are actually affected almost in a similar way. If Kenya is going to be suffering from droughts and Uganda is suffering from drought, but we go to these international climate conferences and we are not speaking as one voice, we are not likely to ensure that the benefits to our people is optimized. And despite some of the agreements, what is happening today is far from justice, because there is a commitment of about $100 billion towards mitigating climate change for LDCs, but only about 3% of that money is getting to the smallholder farmers. Much of that money is falling off somewhere. In the realization of the target is also another area for debate. But how do we ensure that more of that money comes down to solve the real problems of the small-scale farmer? Because the small-scale farmer of today cannot continue producing the way the small-scale farmer 50, 30 years ago did produce. In some communities, irrigation was never heard about. But today, if you cannot irrigate, chances that you're going to have a good harvest are very, very low. The keynote speaker mentioned debt slavery. A lot of the money that is coming in the climate financing is actually loan. So that again perpetuates the debt slavery. So if we as Africa have one voice, then we are able to fight towards this money being grant, because this is justice. If it is justice and we are again borrowing that money, I don't think that is a fair justice. Then we have, and we are the university researchers, there's a need for climate smart agriculture, if we are talking about food security, and climate sensitive development. Lucky enough, Agenda 2063 emphasizes environmentally responsible development, and I think there is need for technologies, research into areas that can enable communities adapt, because without those technologies, the poor people are going to, more of them are going to end up among the hungry. And this is also very important, the keynote speaker addressed it again, indigenous knowledge. When you're talking about sustainable agriculture, there is a lot that can be borrowed from indigenous knowledge. And that is an area which I think the researchers, governments should be exploiting as we talk about climate justice. Now, the discussion of climate justice sometimes is happening mainly in the international space. And we do not do a lot of that discussion within the domestic space. And within the domestic space, there is also injustice. I think there are cases like Nigeria where there's been a lot of discussion about the effect of the petroleum industry on the farming community and the local communities. In Uganda, we are also starting our oil industry. We need to learn from some of those experiences and bring this debate to, you know, to national level. Because while we are indicating that countries that are wealthy are contributing most, we could get into a situation where individuals that are wealthy within one country are contributing a lot, and those who are carrying the burden do not have any justice. So I'd think that we really ought to make this a debate at all levels. We should be sensitizing people, the young people. It's good they are here. And we should all be living responsibly, making sure that our appetite for consumption is tamed. Thank you very much.
Okay. I'm just going to give our keynote speaker a couple of minutes, 5 minutes, to maybe, having listened to the two panelists, also give his views. Then I would like to maybe synthesize or summarize before I pose the last question, and then hopefully open up to a number of questions from the audience.
Thank you to the moderator. I think having said we should focus on ensuring we don't leave anyone behind, is to also thank our panelists for the input they've given. In South Africa, we've been fortunate to be blessed with a generation that was selfless in the likes of my grandfather, but I'd like to speak to one in particular in the presence of young people, being Ahmad Katrada. Which of the young people are under 12 years old here? Raise your hands. Under 12 years old. Which one are under 17 years old? Now, Ahmad Katrada, as a 12-year-old, entered our struggle for liberation in South Africa. As a 17-year-old, he was in the forefront of the struggle for liberation. And as a 22-year-old, could equally stand his ground around the elders, such as my grandfather, Oliver Tambo, Anton Lembede, Ashley Pitamda, Duma Nokwe, Lillian Ngoyi, and would equally debate with them as young as he was. Now I say this because it needs to talk directly to young people and their role and being conscious of who they are and the challenges that lay ahead. In an African family unit, we are broad. It's sometimes pains me when I drive around in many of our towns in South Africa and on the African continent to see kids on the streets that are begging, coming to cars as you drive. It's an African, because in Africa, as a broad family structure, even when your sister, brother, uncle's child is in need, you take them over and you see to them. Such was my grandfather's life. His father passed on at a young age. He was taken and raised by another Madiba, the regent chief Jongintaba Mtika, who raised and cared for him. And therefore, there has to be this real consciousness of grooming and raising young people to understand their role at that particular time and the decades to come ahead. And therefore, I do believe that our schooling itself needs to inculcate in young people their own understanding of the challenges and opportunities that they face on a daily basis. And therefore, when we built a school in Mvezo, the Mandela School of Science and Technology, science and technology wasn't to speak to young people that will suddenly qualify and go and work at a Mercedes-Benz factory in East London, which is 175 kilometers away. Science and technology had to enable them to better understand how they can relate to their village, to the land, to the household gardens they are sitting in. The school had to come up with technologies that could better enable them to produce produce on a quota basis that they can be able to harvest, sell in the community, the surplus sell in the market. So in visiting Malawi as a committee of a parliament of the Republic of South Africa, we came to learn about a project called OVOP, One Village, One Product. And every single village in Malawi is producing a certain product, harvesting it, processing it, packaging it, and getting it in the market. The government has been able to set up OVOP shops. So Malawians will buy first and foremost in supporting their own OVOP shops because they know they are supporting their own villages. They are buying directly from their own communities. And therefore, in ensuring that we are able to look after that space, we can be able to ensure that young people can move out of school and better relate to the piece of land they are located in. But in many African homes, you find that we are living with child-headed homes or even women-headed homes because men are often in factories or in mines, such is the case we find ourselves in South Africa. For many years, urban migration has been the issue where men on the 2nd, 3rd of January would leave the villages to the urban areas, labor there for the whole 11 months, only to come back on the 10th or 15th of December. And therefore, women-focused programs have to be developed to ensure that they are able to look after their own household gardens. We recently visited Brazil with our committee in parliament and came to realize that in Brazil, families were accounting for 70% of agricultural produce, with only half a hectare and a hectare each as a family unit, whereas commercial farmers were only accounting for 30% of produce. And this tells you that in government, working smart, looking as to how best to utilize the fiscus, we can be able to empower small-scale farmers to better understand the land they are located in, provide the support that is much needed for them to effectively plant, produce, and harvest what they can be able to take to the market. Today we happened to drive past the Kampala market, and I'm looking at the market and asking the question, where is the produce coming from? And how is it getting to the market? Who is the consumer? And how is the producer at home being able to get the produce into the market in Kampala? But have we been even able to tap into the greater market in the region and the greater continent? And with the Africa Free Trade Agreement, our borders have been collapsed. We can be able now to trade right across the continent. And I think we need to leverage on that and be able to ensure that African fresh produce is taken broader into the continent and we trade with one another before focusing on the greater global community. But it is a market that we can tap into when you look at countries with huge populations such as China that are looking on Africa to grow food for them. These are markets that we can be able to tap into. And I think it still leaves a lot for us to look into as to how do we come with a holistic approach to combating climate change and ensuring that the lands that we use are at utmost utilized by our people.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And a couple of things that stand out immediately from the submission from the three panelists. First of all, the idea of the youth. The need not only to empower them, but to give them actually a seat at the table to be able to not only negotiate, but also be part and parcel of the decisions that are made and the solutions that are found. I like the idea of climate-proofing Africa. I think I like that idea. I don't know how it will work in real time, but the idea that you will use institutions and resources and development organizations in order to be able to ensure that Africa is climate-proofed. And of course, the second point that you made, and I think has been made and runs through the three panelists here, is the issue of empowering the youth, those below the age of 30, to be able not only to benefit from, but also to be able to present ideas. What I liked about the second panelist is the questions of how to position Africa. Often it comes up, we'll position Africa. How are we going to position it? Who is going to position it? I think that, interestingly enough, in the submission by Chief, I'll just call you Chief if you don't mind, our Chief, the idea that in order to be able to position Africa, one not only needs to, first of all, go down to the lowest level, to the communities that not only consume, but also produce, and being able to see how that works out. Here in Uganda for a while, we've had something called Bubu. Buy Uganda, build Uganda. But I got to a point of understanding that, well, it was a really good idea. It's an idea that if it took root, would definitely build into your idea of ensuring that the people within the rural communities are catered for, but it seems to have leveled off at a certain point, whereby we speak about it, but you don't see the actual way in which it works itself down to the different communities. The second issue that I think that came up very clearly in your presentation, Prof, was the issue of collaboration, working together. Right now, the East African community has been working tirelessly to try to find different avenues in which not only to collaborate economically, but also in terms of socially and educationally, sharing different tools and that are available. I think that
that when you look at other regions and you look at whether it's North America, whether it's South America, whether it's Asian countries, the fact that all of them are coalescing into groups should tell you something, that there's power in being a part of a group. And part of our power here, for example, is being part of the East African community and, of course, later on being part of a wider community of COMESA and so on and so forth. So I think the issue of collaboration definitely comes out very strongly. Finally, I think that in terms of talking about justice and injustice makes the issue much more real. But I think that what you brought up in your submission, Chief, about local injustice. We talk about justice, you know, the Europeans are being unjust, they're consuming and they're producing 25% of the, you know, of the waste, and yet we who consume only 4% are the ones who are being left to actually field it, means that, you know, we are dealing with a different, with different countries. But within our own communities, within our own countries, the issue of injustice has to be addressed in order for us to be able to break down the barriers that have basically been the ones that are holding us hostage in terms of this climate change. That is my basic synthesis of what has been said here, but there's a final question that I'd like to give 2 minutes to each of the panelists to answer, is that we have skirted around this issue of climate change. We've talked about it in broad terms. We've talked about it in terms of the youth. We've talked about it in terms of our communities. We have not talked about it in political terms. Climate change is a political issue. It's a political issue between us and them. It is a political issue even amongst ourselves and others. And I would like to hear your views on the issue of climate change as a political issue. I'll start with you, Ojok.
Thank you very much. So, okay, politically, I may not be in the position of having the experience of politics, but I think, as she said it, climate change is a political agenda to some great extent. You realize, as it was said, the Western countries, for example, or the developed countries that actually have the highest emission of the greenhouse gases, are actually the least affected, while the countries that are doing less of that are the most affected. So there it becomes political, because it places the affected countries in a vulnerable situation. They become desperate for help, and definitely that is already a hotspot for many other problems. So I can talk about, for example, the issue of drought in the Horn of Africa. The drought has literally impaired the agricultural activities that used to be carried out by the local people. And as of now, they seriously need help. At the same time, the source of supply they had, that was Ukraine, that used to supply them with wheat and sunflower oil and all that, is no longer in position to do so. So I really see that it gives the affected country that state of vulnerability, which can cause a lot of problems, can cause infiltration into the government and things like that. I also think that something has to be done in the political space, locally, for example. For example, in Uganda, you gave me 2 minutes.
I give you 2 minutes, but it's okay. Okay. I'll give you an extra minute.
Okay, so I think that the governments should incorporate these issues into their discussion. Once in a while, as we're talking about the iron sheets, I think we can also discuss the impact of climate change on the people of Africa, because that is how we can get the resolutions into how we can affect the issue of climate justice. So I think we should adopt it in the national levels and have it as one of the agendas. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'd like to turn to Prof, and then I'll leave you to be the last one to give a quick submission, 2 minutes.
Thank you very much, moderator. I'll start by pointing, I studied politics on a still all level, and I remember one definition we used to be given, that politics is the science of managing resources, or allocation of scarce resources. So how much of the resources are we actually allocating to climate issues, environmental protection? That is one area where I think politics really becomes central in climate change mitigation. I talked earlier on about things like irrigation. If we needed irrigation, sometimes you need the political muscle in order to allocate the resources. But globally, there's been also a wave of populistic leadership or leaders who are not minding about global issues. The case of countries withdrawing from international conventions, and now the Amazon has had a lot of degradation because of the leadership. I think that is also very important. But when you also think about the vulnerability of the population to climate degradation, conflict is a major factor. And conflict is, to a large extent, driven by politics. So I would imagine that if our politics is in order, then we reduce conflict, and therefore the conflict being a driver for environmental degradation reduces. And lastly, I think policy, if we are going to get the resources allocated, the people educated, like the keynote speaker told us, then you need the relevant policies to make sure that climate change mitigation is part of the agenda. And I think we cannot divorce climate change from politics. And those are some of the examples where it becomes very, very relevant. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Last question, last submission from Chief, before we open it up for about 5 minutes to the audience to give us some questions of their own.
Thank you to the moderator once again. I think for me, the first political space of engagement will be locally. What are we doing in terms of our powers that be, regimes that are in office, in ensuring that we fight the scourge of climate justice and climate change? Is there enough knowledge that is being developed? And this is why I focus on young people in particular, who form the vast majority of the population on the African continent. But also you have women-headed households that we need to ensure that there is enough knowledge in that. So you have to look at the powers be, if are they investing enough into that space? Is there enough budget to develop our own indigenous knowledge and ensure that we are able to combat these challenges? But then country-to-country relations, you have to look at as to how within the SADC region or within East Africa, West Africa, Central Africa, and Maghreb region in the north, how the countries relate with one another in terms of alleviating and resolving the challenges that we face. Are we a continent that should be spending a lot of fiscus on arms and conflict rather than education and fighting climate change? And these are the things I think as a continent need to be prioritized and looked into politically in ensuring that we have a clear common understanding through our regions and through the AU, we speak with one voice. Then comes the issue of the AU in itself, mapping it with other areas, the EU, the US, and the Far East. So you take, for example, we recently had the China-Africa summit. What is Africa trying to achieve out of this summit? We next week are going into a Russia-Africa summit. What are the priorities for African countries going into the Russia-Africa summit, particularly in the conflict that we are witnessing between Russia and Ukraine and the lack of fertilizer into our countries? Are we developing alternatives to fertilizer? Are we developing our own knowledge base of coming with products that will ensure that we are able to produce better and smartly? South Africa on its own will be hosting now the BRICS summit coming August. And as a BRICS country, what would be South Africa doing for the African agenda and enhancing and advancing the Africa agenda within the broader BRICS countries? And you know, we're speaking of opening BRICS. How many other African countries are we looking to bring into BRICS, into occupying that space, so that we can be able to achieve more together? And I think these are the things that I would like to leave as food for thought for us to engage on regional engagements. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I'm not going to summarize that. I'll leave that to the end. For now, I'd like to open the floor up for about, there's so many hands up already. For about five questions.
Has somebody got a mic? Can we start with our freedom fighter here?
My question is basically to all the panelists present. So we live in a world whereby the youth, every single time they get up to speak, for instance, Greta Thunberg, yeah? Every single time they get up to speak, they're basically pushed down by the people in power. For instance, she was pushed down by the former president, Donald Trump, yes? We also live in the very particular world where the people in power themselves are the ones that degrade the environment. So my question is, how do we as youth, how are we empowered to go ahead and fight against climate change?
We'll take three questions and then respond.
Personally, I'm trying to say, I'm gonna open up with, growing up, we have all been told to not litter and those things, but we have the youth, then we have us children, the youngsters, you know, those ones that are very, very young. But what I'm trying to ask is, how are we going to be given that knowledge? Because honestly, sensitization is there, but it's not enough. Because as a child, I learn through two things. One, through experience, and through looking at someone older than me, some influencer who I know, I'm like, yeah, I'm gonna be like that person one day. So I want to know how we are going to be taught that knowledge in a way that we can grow up knowing that this climate change is bad, because even growing up, we have just been told littering is bad, but only in high school is when I understood why littering is bad.
Yes, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Before you is Council Semanda from the MIT School of Law, Makerere University. Basically, I would love to applaud you, Chief Guest, for your wonderful, you know, speech as regards to climate justice in Africa. But my question basically is as regards to neo-colonialism. I'm alive to the fact that in the early days of the African National Congress, during the reign of the likes of Pixley Kaisa Kaseme, he gave a speech at one time at the Columbus University of Columbia. And one of the things he was stressing was the regeneration of Africa. And my question is, where has the regeneration of Africa gone? Because we can use this to arrest the climate injustices that we Africans face. The other question is, how do we address dictatorship in order to achieve climate justice? Because in Africa, we're having situations where there's no goodwill. African nations, and good enough, you're also an MP in South Africa. We go into conventions, we have COP26, COP27, I don't know when we will stop. But you know, recently there was a conference in Sharm el-Sheikh in Egypt. But they all gave recommendations. And some of the recommendations were, that let's all come together, and they gave themselves a number of, you know, trees that they will be planting. But here in Kampala, I am under the office of the mayor of Kampala Central, who is His Worship Salim Uhuru. But as KCC, they haven't even reached 1% of their target to plant trees in Kampala. There is lack of goodwill. How do we arrest this? Thank you.
Thank you very much. I am talking as a teacher, as a mother. I am answering, I'm just responding. You were asking, where do we get knowledge? I testify to say that we have our children, they are in school, they do those things of climate change online. And now my question is, or even my worry, when they are invited to go for conferences, either US, about climate change issues, they are with working with the UN, they are not given visas. I testify, I have a daughter. She is a climate change activist. The other time she went to Egypt for global change, COP conference, and she was supposed to go to other countries on issues of climate change, but denied visa more than 5 times. How are you going to help? They have the knowledge, but also, they are limited. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Please, the questions are as follows, and I'm going to give the opportunity to any of the panelists to be able to answer them, because I think they were fairly generic. How many people, how will the youth be able to do what they're supposed to do if they're constantly pushed down? Yes? The second one is, there is a way in which we are told you shouldn't do X, but the why, don't litter, but the why question doesn't ever come up. The third one is about the regeneration of Africa, when and how. And finally, of course, this relates to issues of voter controls and whereby visas are denied to even climate activists who would like to go and share their knowledge in different spaces. So I'll start from my right and then move to my left. Sorry. Can you keep it very brief? Half a minute.
All right. So about the youth being pushed down by the people in power, I think we were clear about the approach to this at some point, that it's everyone that is supposed to be involved in this activism. So the government in the forefront is supposed to provide the conducive space for the young people to be able to teach the communities and maybe participate in implementing some of the projects. But yes, personally, I'm not really certain about maybe if people have been pushed off when they were trying to implement some of the projects. Yeah, but I believe that is a discrepancy, and it should be favorable from the government level for the youth to be able to do what they can do. Thank you.
Prof.
Thank you. About the youth, today we are celebrating Nelson Mandela. They tried to push him, and he got up. And some of the strongest activists as far as the climate change is concerned today are actually young. They are very young. So be encouraged by these examples. Nothing is going to come on a silver platter. If you want something, you're going to get into the fighting spirit, and you will be able to achieve success. Knowledge about environmental responsibility and examples. I think good enough we are speaking to a lot of adults. We should be exemplary, because if we are telling them don't litter and we litter, then we don't tell them why they shouldn't litter, then the lessons are missed. So let's be, actually, if you're driving around, you get surprised that a well-dressed gentleman in a suit is throwing out a mineral water bottle. And then the same person is going to try to tell his son or daughter who is in the vehicle that be responsible. So that, I think, is not likely to happen. A comment about regeneration of Africa. I think I see you should be part of the journey. Because if you leave it to the keynote speaker or anybody, this is important, and everybody should get on track. If you are involved with the KCCA and nothing has happened, what can you do as you? We all should try to carry some of the weight towards this regeneration of Africa. Thank you.
Chief.
Thank you. Perhaps to deal with the issue of youth and youth being pushed down, you spoke about the last speech Madiba made on the dock, and when he speaks about fighting against white domination as well as fighting against black domination, you should truly understand what that means. You know, as youth that established the ANC Youth League in 1944, their first task was to challenge the status quo, which was being perpetuated by our elders, who were for decades, since the inception of founding of the African National Congress, were used to writing petitions and sending petitions to the government. And that youth took a stand, not in our time, and therefore turned the tide. They came back with a new agenda of militant protests to be out in the streets to defying every unjust law put by the apartheid regime. And in so doing, that youth, understanding very well that Madiba was from a royal family and a chief himself, sent him to his president, which was Bitini Khuma of the ANC, who was a subject to Madiba in the rural areas as per tradition. And Madiba challenged the president to say that we want to support you, but you would have to adopt the new agenda that is being advocated by young people. And as a result, when Bitini Khuma didn't support that, they went and voted for a totally different individual, being J.S. Moroka. And this is how J.S. Moroka came into office, with the support of young people. I therefore say to you and challenge young people throughout our continent, be knowledgeable, have an education, be clear on the numbers that you have and utilize those numbers to be a voice of the future generations. Today, we have young people that simply want to chase positions without coming together as a collective. And you must remember that that generation of the leaders and the founders of OAU were the elitists of Africa. They were highly educated and therefore could be able to articulate their thoughts and ideas and bring about the necessary change that the continent needed. And therefore, I wanted to leave that to resonate with young people in particular. And instead of always looking at the elders and criticizing the elders, better find yourselves as who are you as young people? Where are you located in the political arena? What numbers do you have in order to ensure that you are able to uplift your own contributions? And I think forming the vast majority of the population in the continent, we rely on those young minds and their innovativeness to bring about the necessary change that we want. If we are to combat climate change and climate justice, we need young people to come to the arena and participate. But you shouldn't be driven by positions, because lest you find yourselves being the rot that we're trying to rid ourselves, self-serving leaders that are interested only in their pockets. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will take two more questions. In the interest of time, we'll take two more questions. There's a young person over there and another youngish person just behind there. So we'll take those two questions and then we'll wrap it up for today. Yeah, this youngish person and that very young person over there.
Thank you very much, Doctor.
Yes, you.
My name is Akidega Moses. I'm a student of law at Makerere University. I'm from the Council of Uganda. My first question is, how are we going to deal with Western hypocrisy? At the height of the Stop ECOP campaign here in Uganda, ECOP is the East African crude oil pipeline that begins from the Albertine region and goes all the way to Tanga in Tanzania. At the height of that campaign, it was climaxed by a European Union resolution in an attempt to halt that particular development. So the question is that in the same period of time, we saw the USA issuing licenses to new oil and gas mining companies, and particularly in the Arctic Sea. And at the same time, we saw Germany issuing new licenses to oil and gas companies in the North Sea. So the people who are advancing and telling us that let us plant more trees are at the same time exploring their natural resources. So how can we equip the African Union as Africa's lead negotiator to equip itself with capacity to negotiate for what really belongs to Africa, well knowing that the biggest emissions come from that part of the world? Two is that we acknowledge that Africa is in its industrial era. And our need for energy is increasing to run our industries and to run all these companies that we are putting up. So how do we strike a balance between the actual reality of sustainable development, where we must, yes, exploit resources, but with a mindset of sustainability, but at the same time, our own development as a continent? So I don't know, how do we finance our development amid this, the actual reality? Thank you.
And finally, the last person, the last question. I was mistaken. I thought he was a very young person, but clearly not. So maybe I take it away and give it to another young person. But I will give it to you, and also to finally to Her Excellency, Madame Lulu.
thank you. I actually thank God that I was mistaken to be a young person. You never know. Protocol observed, I'm based on Mutambi Nkrumah, and I just have one point to discuss with us today. Kwame Nkrumah, one of the greatest Pan-Africanists and the true son of African land, had this to say, that at first achieve political kingdom, then these other things shall be added to us. In the first place, we must achieve political kingdom, because there is no way we are going to address climate injustice, food insecurity, when we still have this political hypocrisy in Africa. We have political hypocrisy. Africans, we are not problem solvers. We are being political preachers, we are orators, we give solutions, but we are not doing anything. We must wake up, raise, and implement, because we are not the only people who were colonized. India, Singapore, America itself.
Thank you very much.
So we must rise up.
Thank you. Last but not least, I'd like you to hand over the mic to Her Excellency Ambassador Lulu.
Thank you. I'm sorry to come back, but I was provoked by the panelists here. My question, let me start there, is similar to his question. How do we deal with the double standard? In South Africa, we're told coal is dirty. I guess we must throw it into the sea, and we have loads of reserves, maybe 200-year reserves underground. Now, once we're listening and we're told about climate justice transition, what is it? Just transition. Europe is buying, he just said, they are buying coal, our coal. Germany, the UK. After the war in Ukraine, some of them bombed the pipeline from Russia, or they did sanctions, and sanctions hit them back. They don't have oil, they don't have gas, and it's winter there. So because now they were freezing, they ordered our coal from Europe, from America, from UK, they are ordering our coal. So how do we deal with that? But my main question is, can we really, these people who are talking about these justices and what, they have developed their countries, they have industrialized using coal and oil and gas and all that. Can we really build a smelter? Here in Uganda, you have loads of iron ore. Can you produce steel from wind energy, from solar energy? Can you produce steel? Can you process your gold using wind and solar? Those forms of energy are very weak, unfortunately, to be able to run these important industries. So I think, for me, yes, we can plant trees and make sure that we're contributing our part, but there must be justice in it. In South Africa, I think over 300 families we lose jobs if we stop coal mining today. Where are those families going to go? So those are the questions I had. But just to say, my last message to the young people, Nelson Mandela said, education is the most powerful weapon which you can use to change the world. So I want all of you to go to school and not run to parliament. Parliament time will come, but first, go and arm yourself with education. Let me thank our keynote speaker. The last time I saw him, he was a very, very young man. And I thought, hey, let him come, I don't know. And he was very militant. He goes to Algeria, tells them about the Western Sahara, the last colony of Africa. He goes to Palestine, Israel, tells them. that you are committing crimes against humanity. So I'm just saying, well done. I didn't know you are also a scientist. And I just want to say, President Mandela was 6 feet 5 inches. He is 6 feet 4 inches. He still has to grow. Thank you.
Our questions come to an end here. The questions are, some are questions, some are comments, and I would like to give an opportunity to the panelists for half a minute each to answer only one of the questions. Decide on which one really poked you and what you really would like to answer to that one. So half a minute for the question. If you want me to repeat them, I can. There was the one from Mr. Kidega over there about politics and political injustice, actually, I think is what you were trying to talk about. Then we had the last one from the young man also veering towards the issue of injustice and wondering how why we would accommodate the wishes or interests of Western countries when in actual fact they're doing the reverse. Finally, of course, with Her Excellency Ambassador Lulu, again, comments about the fact that we might not be able to industrialize as fast as we'd like if we were to use the kind of energy that we are being asked to do. To use as opposed to energy which others have used in order to get to where they are.
Thank you very much. There is a saying that Africa is to development what Mars is to NASA. I think we know about NASA, that institution in America that is promising people every year that is going to take them to Mars. So someone related that is Dambisa Moyo in her book, that Africa is actually to development what Mars is to NASA. So why development is not occurring in Africa is because we fail to implement policies. And just to answer one question from Mr. Chidega Moses about the evolution of industrialization in Africa and how we can keep in mind the use of the safe energy sources. So I think it comes back to the government. Like, the government has to be in the forefront in implementing the safe energy sources. If, for example, we say we're going to use solars, like, what is the efficiency of the solars we are trying to use? Like, are they supposed to sustain these industries that are maybe producing things? So, and maybe away from that, I think the industries also are supposed to be censored. Okay, for an industry to work, it has to follow some policies that have been formulated by the government. And so at the end of the day, they are not producing or emitting the gases beyond is expected. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next, I'd like Prof to answer.
Yeah, thank you very much for the questions. Moses, and I think Your Excellency, my thinking is you're emphasizing the need for climate justice, rather than actually thinking it's the bad thing to do, because the whole argument is people that have contributed most should pay the price. And there are also advocates, as I mentioned earlier, who say, let them allow us also to contribute, but that is something that is due for debate. But climate justice is really not encouraging hypocrisy. The hypocrisy is part of the climate injustice. That's what I would think. And for the gentleman who quoted Kwame Nkrumah, good enough you said Africans. And you're an African, please get onto the battleground and let's change the continent. I think one of the problems we have is over dependence. African, and some leaders have been complaining that all these 50-something presidents are summoned and they have meeting the other one president. We need to get less dependent, and that is going to be about us making sure that our house is in order and we can put our resources to the important things so that we don't have to wait to beg the Europeans and therefore follow their agenda. Thank you.
Chief?
We have an African saying that says, if you want to walk fast, you walk alone. But if you want to walk a great distance, we walk together. Now, this is what Africa needs. In solving African problems, we need African solutions. And therefore, in always looking to the West or to our colonizers, you may not find solutions that are better suited for Africa. And it is vital now, I mean, as a traditional leader living in the Eastern Cape on a coastal line, where colonizers, when they arrived, developed Durban and developed Cape Town as rapid as they wanted, and there's a beach road on both cities that is right on the beach. Now, when it's our time as traditional leaders who are holding these coastal lands in the Eastern Cape, it's even coined the Wild Coast. You must ever visit the South Africa, visit the Wild Coast. And we are told that now you can't build on the beachfront. You must build 5-10 kilometers away for saving the eco-environment. And we're saying that if you assess any development that you did as colonizers in this brutal apartheid regime, you neglected that and built right on top of the beach. And the opportunity is vested in lying with us today to create jobs, to empower our youth, women, and Africans in general. And therefore, we need to focus on finding those solutions as Africans that are better suited for our communities and our nations. And I think the model that is vested with us was already founded by the founding fathers of the OAU, which is now the African Union. And I think we can work together in finding solutions and stop looking to the West or to the former colonizers for solutions. And I think that is where Africa will be able to advance rapidly in resolving its challenges. Thank you.
Thank you very much. As we wrap up the session, this moderated session, I'd like to end by saying that I think everything that's been said today really resonates, not only in terms of Africa as a whole, but specifically for us as Ugandans. In our own context, Uganda has the youngest age structure in the whole world, with 77% of its population under the age of 30. Now, the population of Uganda is currently growing by about 1 million people per year. That should give us pause, because with that, you have to understand that the people at the forefront of the fight, the people at the forefront of ensuring that there is climate justice, the people at the front, at the forefront of being able to create the kind of structures and demand their place at the table when it comes to negotiations about climate change or even articulating it, are actually young people. Finally, I think that what is important
and what has been said today by our keynote speaker, by the panelists, is that yes, we accept there are injustices, and we accept that there are injustices. And a part of the discussion was how to overcome those injustices. The second part of the conversation that we've been having this afternoon is not only how are we going to overcome that, the injustice that exists, but to ensure that that injustice is not overlooked, the local injustices are not overlooked, as we look to Europe and so on and so forth. Finally, the issue of collaboration, that in order to be able to walk the talk that we're talking about climate change and resilience, that we need to collaborate not only as individuals, but as Africans and people within on the same continent. Finally, the message that has been set and has been given by the keynote speaker, I think resonates at different levels. The fact that you cannot fight when you don't have an agenda. You cannot fight when you don't have the tools. You cannot fight if you don't have the resources. So for young people to be able, the 1 million that is every year increasing in our population, they must have the resources. They must have the agenda. And in order for you to deserve a place and to demand for a place at that table, you must have the agenda, the resources, and the intentional way of doing various changes. Thank you very much. And I'd like to thank my panelists, Moses Ajok, Professor Mayongo, and Chief. Thank you very much.
A round of applause for the panel that has just been very engaging. Thank you so much, Dr. Susie, for the well-moderated panel, and thank you to the panelists for the insights. Thank you to the audience for being attentive and engaging. Allow me to welcome the Chair Counsel of the University Council to give her concluding remarks.
Please allow me to first request that we give another round of applause to our panelists and the moderator of the panel. That was excellent. Thank you very much. The guest of honor, Your Excellency Lulama Mary Teresa Zingwana, the South African High Commissioner to Uganda, the Honorable Mandla Mandela, Member of Parliament, Republic of South Africa, and our keynote speaker, members of the University Council present, the Acting Vice Chancellor, Professor Hisali, members of the Diplomatic Corps, our students and young people, the future of this continent, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, what an exciting afternoon we've just had. It gives me great pleasure to give the concluding remarks to such an exhilarating 2023 annual Nelson Mandela public lecture, commemorating 10 years since his passing. Permit me, on behalf of Makerere University, to thank Your Excellency Lulama Mary Teresa and the South African High Commissioner and the South African community for again choosing our beloved campus to host this distinguished lecture based on a theme that embodies Madiba's dream for an Africa he so valiantly fought for. The keynote, the key takeaway for me are really that there are two things, basically. One is that Africa must come together to address its problems. We must, first of all, sort out or solve the issue of identity as Africans. We cannot be